I graduated from college and from graduate school with music degrees in education and in performance. I surrounded myself with other music students, and all we did was talk about music all the time. So that's always made it difficult for me to do the 70s presentation, because I have strong opinions and I want to try to keep some of those out and make it more general. I want you to tell me how I did later and see if you enjoyed this or not. This is my brother's 1970 Chevelle SS396. Thank you, gentlemen. I always get some guy support there. It's not actually my brother's car, but he had one that looked exactly like it. So cool. He let me borrow it today. And so my friends, all of my friends, we're going to get our 8-track tapes, and we're going to go riding around listening to some early 70s music. This is what we were listening to. But just raise your hand if, like me, you're a 70s guy. The 70s decade was, thank you, okay, kind of special for you, like it was for me. All right, so I hope that triggered some memories, maybe the friends that you enjoyed that music with, like it did me. And we were listening on 8-track tapes, right? Because gas was cheap, remember? And we could take our 8-tracks and put them in everybody's car and drive around and listen to the music and enjoy it and share it together. But we still had AM radios in our car. But the other big thing that happened in the 70s, really the late 60s, was the advance of FM radio and the programming called AOR, album-oriented rock. FM stations played different music than AM stations, which were very commercial, of course. It seems like there were fewer ads on FM stations, and so they would play music that you might never hear on AM stations, and they would also play longer tracks. Sometimes when a new album came out, they'd play the entire album, have a commercial, and then flip it and play the entire album, and we'd all tape it off the radio, if you remember, because we were too cheap to buy it. All right. I used, as always, the Billboard Hot 100 as a starting off point, but I just use it a little bit, because now I want to talk about, to start us off, 1970. The big music news of that year is that the Beatles officially broke up, ending one of the most amazing music collaborations that lasted only around 10 years. And this was the number one song in 1970, according to Billboard. I want to start with soft rock. And by that, I mean perhaps some of these artists, some of these albums you may have collected. Soft rock was commercial. It was inoffensive and romantic sometimes if you were on a date. Here's a few examples of soft rock. If a face could lie. How many people owned this album? Yeah, lots of hands went up. I owned it 6 ways from Sunday. I had it on a record. I had to replace the record. I got it on an 8-track. I got it eventually on a CD. If there was a way that Carole King could sell me that album, I'd line up and say, take my money, please. It was released in 1971, and it won the Grammy Album of the Year. Who in here was in marching band in school? Thank you. Me too. I love all the band nerds. We're in step together, right? All of my friends in band, and then, of course, I was in the college marching band, we loved horn bands. And by that, I mean some of these groups. Now, you don't have to be in band to like these groups, but we liked them because they were playing instruments that we played in band, trombone and sax and trumpet and things like that. And they had a really great sound as a result. A lot of the players came from jazz backgrounds and were very capable players. So these are some of the examples of horn bands. Concert, which leads me into arena rock, which is not really a genre of music. It's more geography. The Beatles, to go back to my favorite group, became so popular that they started appearing in stadiums and outdoor venues, and yet their amplifiers weren't up to snuff because they were tiny little amps that couldn't project the sound out in a large stadium that had no roof or anything. And then the crowds were screaming so much that no one could hear anything except the screams. The Beatles literally couldn't hear each other play. So in the 70s, technology caught up with the bands. They had much bigger speakers, much bigger amps, better sound systems, and they were able to put on concerts outdoors or indoors in big arenas. And the other thing about arena rock is that, you know, I always just wanted to go see the band play. I wanted to see Chicago playing their instruments, playing the songs that I heard on the record. Well, that wasn't enough as we proceed into the 70s. Now you went because you wanted to buy the T-shirt so you could wear it to school the next day, right? And so all the stuff that they had for sale. And then they had to have something big happen, confetti fall down, or the lights going crazy, or laser shows, or, well, let's see a few examples of arena rock. I see a little silhouette of a man. Other genres. I want to go into soul and funk. Now, we've talked about rhythm and blues out of the 50s and how that evolved and what happened in the 60s to make it more mainstream. In the 70s, we get a couple of diverging tracks. Rhythm and blues was also called soul music. Who had the most number one hits in this decade? And there are three groups or artists tied for third place with five number one hits in this decade. The first one we're going to look at is Stevie Wonder. There is superstition. Right hands on the wall. A lot of clips that I was able to find on YouTube and other places. We didn't have MTV, did we? But we did have some pretty good TV shows. American Bandstand first appeared in
disco.
Any disco fans in here? Okay, did you go to discotheques, get dressed up, and dance to the music? That's what it was. Here's a few disco hits. If you need to get up and dance, I won't stop you. That's the way of my life. It's fun to stay at the YMCA. There you go. I had graduated from college, and my friends and I, and maybe same thing with your group, the people that you rode around listening to 8-track tapes together, and you were sharing that music physically in the same space, we were, some were married, starting careers, you just separate. And so I listened to different music than my friends. I was listening to Steely Dan. Well, I did not think a girl could be so rude. While some of my friends were listening to ABBA. If you change your mind, take a chance. I'm the first in line. Honey, I'm still free. Take a chance on me. But in 1980, though, about 70 Sharonas were born, usually attributed to this song. And here is Sharona Alperin, as featured in the Wall Street Journal in 2019, upon the 40th anniversary of the song. How old does that make you feel? She's a real estate agent in Los Angeles. She says people come up to her all the time and says, oh, your name is Sharona? Like the song? Yes, like the song. So we talk about all the different genres and stuff. And listen, I like what Billy Joel says, hot funk, cool punk, even if it's old junk, it's still rock and roll to me. And you're welcome to join me. And I divide music into two categories, music I like and music I don't like. And you can have those same two categories. That brings us to the end of this presentation. I hope you still have your platform shoes. And I want to thank you for sharing this music with me today. And I'm Larry Hess, and my family's going to be in Club 6. We'd love to say hi to you if you got the time. Thanks for coming. Tomorrow's the 80s. Thank you.